I have already given the example because it's too popular, too well known, you know. It is too well known. You must have heard of the royal disease, isn't it? The British queen had this disease and then it became a big news. Otherwise, it is no different from any other disease. Okay. Just because a royalty had it, it has become famous. Clear? Now, watch this scenario. Father is normal. Mother is affected. And she has got an X-linked recessive gene. X-linked recessive gene. That means she has a gene. It would have expressed itself, but it is not doing so because the other gene is dominant. The normal X is there that suppresses the recessive gene. Therefore, here is a scenario we are discussing where the male or the father is normal. He has a dominant X. The mother is capital X, small x, but the small x is recessive. It is a defective X. Therefore, normal father and a carrier mother is the scenario presented to you. Normal father and a carrier mother. That means the mother is not actually suffering from the disease because the phenotypic expression of the disease is suppressed by the normal X. But she is a carrier. That's why half blue, half yellow or half orange color in this diagram. Would you agree that this is the four gene components you are going to analyze with respect to this particular disease? Is there any discrepancy in the items I have selected for the cross pairing?
Sir, for the maternal capital X should be there if she's a carrier.
What about others? This is a very interesting question. The answer is neither S nor no. The answer is neither S nor no, but I want you to give me the answer. Anybody else would like to dispute this point? I have given you the answer. It is neither S nor no.
Because maybe like mother is a carrier, it's not an affected one.
Then how can it be capital X?
If it's capital X, it means dominant, but here you say it's recessive, so it must be.
Isn't it? So I have gone by this hypothesis that if it is recessive, it should be small x. But I have been faithful enough to say it is in red. Okay. Any disputes, this is a very controversial thing. That's why I want you to answer. Answer therefore is yes and no. I have used the small x and I made it in red because mother is a carrier. That gene is suppressed and it is a recessive gene. Okay. Now, what are the options? What are the four options you will get? Tell me. Square number one, what will you get?
Capital X and red small x.
Capital X and red small x. So, what is the outcome? Carrier female.
Similar.
Wherever there is a small red X, you will end up as a capital, as a carrier female. Okay. Carrier. That means it is not expressed, but the gene is there. Next one, small x, capital Y. This one. That means small x, capital Y. What will be the presenting symptom?
Affected male.
Affected male.
Affected male. Why?
Because there's X still is expressed because Y.
No, there is no suppressing X here, isn't it? There is no other X. There is only one X. It doesn't matter whether it is recessive or whether it is dominant. Because the other pair is a Y, which has nothing to do with this problem. So therefore, here you have a situation where the maternal X from the carrier mother has been brought down and the sex of the child is male. In a male child, there is only one X chromosome. Unfortunately, that X chromosome has a recessive gene. Although the gene is recessive, it is expressing itself because the other dominant gene is missing. Okay. It is like the story of in the country of the blind, the one-eyed man is the king. That means unopposed, unrestricted gene expression of the recessive allele is possible provided the other gene, there is no other gene to control it. Did you get this point, please? Yes or no? Yes or no?
So can you explain again?
Yes, let me explain again. That's why I am going slow. Let me put on the four squares. Do you agree with these four?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, we are not worried about the lower two. We are not worried about the lower two because there is no problem. We are worried about the upper two, of which X and X is also nothing to worry because it is phenotypically normal, but she is a carrier. The daughter offspring is a carrier. But we are very worried about the next one, small x, capital Y. And unfortunately, that small x is a red X. Red, small, X and a capital Y. This condition expresses itself even in the recessive stage of the X. Did you get this point? This condition expresses itself even in the recessive stage. Why? Because the other controlling X is missing. Instead, there is a Y. As a result, here is a case of a male with the gene for hemophilia related disease is recessive yet expressed. Therefore, this is a very, very interesting case of X chromosomal recessive inheritance, where even in the recessive stage, it expresses itself because the corresponding X for the dominance is missing and there is a Y which is useless as far as this particular disease and its amino acid and the protein is concerned. Is it crystal clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Anybody else? Yes. Therefore, this is why sex chromosomal inheritance, there are two things. This is why sex chromosomal inheritance differs from autosomal inheritance. In autosomal inheritance, there is always a capital X and a small x with reference to a disease. Any gene will have a capital component and a small component, a dominant component and a small. But in the case of sex chromosomal inheritance, although there is a dominant gene and a recessive gene, circumstances relating to the formation of the sex of the individual provides opportunity for a recessive gene to express itself. That is the specialty of X-linked inheritance. I hope I have made this crystal clear. This is the essence of today's discussion. Okay? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Next. Now, let's try to extract interpretations out of this square that you made. See, in males, a recessive gene of the X is always expressed even though it is in a single dose. That's what I told you all along. A recessive gene in the male is getting expressed phenotypically even though it is in a single dose. Therefore, it is always the males who actually suffer from hemophilia. It's always the males that suffer from hemophilia. And the daughters, either they may be normal or they may be carriers of hemophilia, but generally speaking, by and large, they don't suffer from the disease because invariably in the carrier, there is always a dominant gene which suppresses the hemophilia problematic gene. If you have understood this question, this pattern correctly, I have a question for you. Have you understood? Can I proceed further, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the question is, very, very rarely, is it possible for a female to suffer from hemophilia? Yes or no?
Yes.
At least theoretically?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
At least theoretically, is it possible for a female to actually suffer from hemophilia phenotypically?
Yes.
When?
When the,
so when the father is the
when there's the a carrier father and a hemophiliac father.
When there is a double dose of recessive genes, isn't it? Small x and small x is also possible. Just like capital X and capital X is possible. By the same combination, sometimes the gene can come from both the father as well as the, that means if the mother is a carrier, or if the mother is a carrier and father is a affected person, in such a case the daughter may actually get, there is a possibility, okay, that she may end up with small x, both the x's may be red in color, in which case they can actually manifest with hemophilia, but that is extremely rare. You know, such things don't occur because there are certain mechanisms in the when the sperm and the x is the combination, when it occurs, defective genes generally they get eliminated to a larger extent, and there are certain mechanisms by which this gene pool is handled safely. Okay, I it's beyond my competence to explain this, but suffice to understand at the first MBBS level that such a possibility of a female actually suffering from hemophilia in the homozygous X stage, that means both are small x, is extremely rare, but technically, theoretically possible. Next, this is therefore today's story. I'm almost reaching the end of my slides. Absence of complementary gene on the other chromosome is being taken advantage of. This is what is happening in this case of sex chromosomal inheritance. Okay, next, let's extract some interpretations from what we have learned. I must compliment this batch because all the three these things, you were able to answer the squares properly and you were able to reasonably well appreciate the interpretation. Watch this. The heterozygous mother is called carrier because she has one copy of the recessive allele. If she has a small x and a capital X, and if the small x is in red, that means she is not suffering, but she is a carrier. This is how we define a carrier. A carrier need not be the person suffering. A sufferer is a carrier, that's a different thing. But the carrier need not suffer, you see. If the female is suffering, then she is invariably a carrier, there is no doubt. But if she is a carrier, she need not suffer because there is another gene dominant and suppressing this small x. Did you understand this point?
Yes, sir.
Next. Sons have therefore 50% probability to be affected. Next. 50% of the daughters will also be having the same probability, but if they get, they will get only carrier status. You see, 50% of the sons will actually get the disease, but 50% of the daughters, if they get the gene, they are likely to be carriers, not the disease sufferers. You see, I am just increasing the depth of the understanding of the term carrier. If the daughter is a carrier, 50% probability is these daughters will end up as carriers, or they will be normal. But the chance of these daughters ending both as carriers and sufferers is extremely rare. Okay. Shall I proceed further, please? Now, in summary, affected fathers cannot pass the X-linked recessive trait to their son. Why? An affected father cannot pass an X-linked recessive gene to their sons. Why?
No, because the father only contributes the Y chromosome.
Exactly, isn't it? The X is, the corresponding X is not contributed by the father. As a result, this is another interpretation that you can extract out of this Punnett square test that you have done in the last three scenarios. Now, it's the reverse of what we saw earlier. While X-linked dominance was more common in females, X-linked recessive is more dominant in males. This is due to the fact that males possess only one single X chromosome and therefore require only one mutated X in order to be affected. Okay, this is the grand summary of today's discussion. Next, women possess two X chromosomes, thus most receive two of the mutated recessive X chromosome from each parent, whereas male, because of this I told you single dose expression, because the other dose is either not there or has a meaningless influence, that is the Y, males are more commonly affected than females in the case of X-linked recessive inheritance. Example, hemophilia, partial color blindness, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency, and lastly Duchenne muscular dystrophy, of which only hemophilia I have highlighted. Other diseases you will understand in due course. Next, there is a separate class was warranted for this sex-linked inheritance because there is an unpaired gene scenario. Therefore, now we go on to the next one. Just like you had an X chromosome linked transmission, is it at least theoretically possible that there can be a Y linked gene transmission? Think and answer. I have all the time focused only on X linked, so much so the word sex linked is otherwise also called as X-linked. So to that extent, we are ignoring the Y chromosome. Can there be any disease that can be transmitted through the Y chromosome? Answer, please.
It should be possible.
Should be possible. Will all of you agree on this? Technically, yes. Why not?
Yeah.
Yes, all of you unanimously, yes, it is possible. But it doesn't really so happen, because if there is a mutant gene in the Y, which is a very critical pool of genes meant for sex determination, particularly the non-homologous regions, if such a gene mutation occurs, it's generally fatal. It is not consistent with life. So, although technically this is possible, in reality, this may not occur, because invariably, either at the time of fertilization itself, the embryo is destroyed, or even if at the most the embryo grows up to say a 100 cell stage, it may end up in an abortion or self-destruction because it is not compatible with life. That is why we don't see such cases. But that doesn't mean this cannot occur. Second point, it is not always the disease. Because there is a disease, we try to understand inheritance. But remember, for every disease that you discuss, there are hundreds and thousands of genes which are expressing normal patterns. For example, the hairy pinna, the pattern of hairs that is there in the male pinna is actually a true Y-linked inheritance. And it expresses, it is there, and it is not lethal. Okay, therefore, with these words of caution, I will end this discussion on this Y-linked inheritance as if such a thing does not exist. That means it has no consequence, because if at all you see some gene expressions, it is normal, like the pinna of the hair pattern in the pinna. Therefore, Y-linked inheritance is a condition where if it is present, it is expressed. You see, there is only one way. You don't need an X to express it. Therefore, if this is so, disease or no disease, disease or even if it's a trait, father will pass this trait to all his sons invariably. Therefore, when this Y is completely eliminated from the discussion because of this nature, there is only one inheritance as far as sex is concerned, X-linked inheritance. So much so, if the thing is present, it shows in the male. If it is not present, it doesn't show in the male. In the female, it's different because there is a dominant gene. Clear? This is the fine summary of today's discussion. In case of Y-linked inheritance, it is an unpaired gene scenario. By the word unpaired gene, there is no corresponding X which will inhibit the Y. As a result, if the gene is present in any corner of the Y, it has to express itself phenotypically. Hence, repeating the attention, please. Hence, in case of X-linked inheritance and Y-linked inheritance, sex-linked inheritance, there is no question of dominance or recessive, particularly applicable in this case. In fact, there are some authorities in genetics who have even said, for this pattern of inheritance, we should not use the word dominant or recessive. It is there, but then when you use it, it makes it understandable, but that's all.